I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Stand up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright with my TV guidance counselor.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV guidance counselor. This is the show where each and every week I welcome an interesting person to the show. We discuss classic television and what they would watch in history using a back issue of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway into our conversation. And this week, my guest is a fellow TV podcaster. My guest is Ashley Ray of the podcast TV I Say with Ashley Ray. I wish I had a name that rhymed with something. I guess it would be like Stuff You Need with Ken Reed, but that's a lot of pressure. But anyway, her show is great. If you are unfamiliar with my show and you're checking it out for the first time because you're a fan of Ashley, welcome. You have excellent taste. I think you will like the show very much. If you are a fan of my show and you haven't heard her show, definitely check it out. She is also a comedian and a writer and just really talented and super cool. And I had a great time talking to her. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest of TV I Say. It's Ashley Ray.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Live from an undisclosed location in South America. Ashley Ray, how are you?
Good. Yeah, South America. I'm here in Colombia on a little trip visiting some friends. I'm doing good.
Have you ever been there before?
No, this is my first time. And I'm doing like 3 weeks. I was in Medellin. Now I'm in Bogota. We're going to go to Santa Marta. So I'm really taking it
all. Oh, nice. Do you speak Spanish at all?
Not well. Me, I mean, I took Spanish for 4 years in high school and it's crazy. I cannot, like, I can barely get sentences together.
Same here. I worked in restaurants forever, so I could have like a really dirty argument with somebody, but that's not super helpful.
Yeah. Like, I can read it, and then the second they ask me a question, I'm just like, lo siento.
Yeah, yeah. Well, at least we have smartphones now.
Exactly.
Knowing that you're a fellow TV obsessive with your podcast, when you travel to other countries, like, the two things I do when I get to another country are I immediately go to a grocery store. Because I like walking around weird grocery stores.
Oh, yeah.
And two,
I love walking around grocery stores and pharmacies in other countries,
right?
And just being like, whoa, look at these actually real vegetables and like medicine that doesn't have a bunch of unnecessary stuff.
Oh, yeah. And then I'm also like, look, they have an American section. And it's always the funniest stuff. I'm like, this sums up what they think of us in two shelves. It's like marshmallows and Doritos. But then the second thing I do is I immediately find a local TV station and see what they're airing.
Yeah, I don't really do that. I probably should. When I lived in Germany for a bit and I would try to like watch local shows mostly to like help my German. I bet if I was watching Spanish shows, it might help. But I usually, honestly, the first thing I do is I like get a VPN on all my devices so I can keep watching American shows that I
right.
keep up with.
How very American of you.
Yes.
Well, it's also like today, like I, not that LA is a different country, but whenever I would be in Los Angeles, my favorite thing to do is watch Good Day LA because it's just a wonderful train wreck of awesomeness. And
yeah, love Good Day
so
LA.
Good. But I recently figured out that Roku, you can stream every single like Fox affiliate in the whole country. So you can just watch it from anywhere. So presumably you could do something similar for foreign television now. So it's not quite the same.
Yeah. I use Hulu with live TV. I don't recommend it. It forces you to like set your home location. So mine is always just like, you only get LA TV.
Yeah. I bought a VPN just so I could watch, CTV in Canada. Has a streaming service, but they have tons of 80s shows that aren't ever released here.
Oh yeah, they get a lot of good British shows too, and I feel like there was like a time when CTV was like airing some American comedies the day before they aired in America.
Oh wow.
So like Parks and Recreation, 30 Rock would air on CTV on like Wednesday, and then America it came on like Thursday, and all the internet nerds would like download it, and you could watch it early if you knew how to torrent or, you know, go to a pirate site.
That was like their revenge for the money exchange rate. Yeah. They're like, oh, your money's worth more. Exactly. Well, we get your shows a day early. So how about that?
About that? There you go.
So when I asked you about doing the show, you picked an issue here from November 24th to the 30th, 1990, which I think is like a birthday week for you, right?
Yes, that's my birthday. My birthday is November 28th. So I was like, I want to see what's going on. What was my mom watching in the hospital that week? You know, what was she
and
doing?
And by birthday, you mean actual birthday.
Yeah, my actual birth. Yes. Like, I didn't exist when at the start of the week. And then that, like, I think Wednesday, there I was.
Do you know what time you were born?
I do, actually, 5:34 a.m.
Oh, so we can look up, like, literally what's on. Although this is...
I could really, like, look up, like, at the time I was born, like, what was she watching? She probably had something on the hospital
we'll
TV.
We'll have to do the conversion, because you grew up in Rockford, Illinois, right?
I grew up in Rockford. I was born in Dallas, Texas. Oh, same time zone.
So, and this is a Boston edition. So, you know, we'd have to do some adjustments, but we could find out. It's possible.
We could figure it out.
Absolutely. So that's interesting. Okay. So this is completely foreign to you in a lot of ways, in that most people don't remember the television from the year they were born. But have you gone back and revisited stuff from like the 90s, or especially 1990?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm a TV obsessive. You know, like I said, I have my podcast, TV I Say with Ashley Ray. And that's something that started when I was just really young. Like, my mom loved TV. She's the one who used to just keep me up, like, watching Nick at Night with her. So I fell in love with so many old shows, Golden Girls, Designing Women. You know, I honestly, looking through this, I was just like, oh, these are all shows I watch all the time. So, you know, I feel like I have a real respect for like 80s, 90s sitcoms. And that's why to this day, I still love like a network family sitcom.
Even though I watch them and I so desperately want them to be good, and they never are now. Like, multicam sitcoms are just, cause they're so good when we were growing up, and I'm almost exactly 10 years older than you. And it's just like, oh, but what are you doing?
Yeah, you know, I still watch the Goldbergs, which, you know, it had a good run somewhere in its 10 seasons. It was pretty good. And, you know, I love that Abbott Elementary is getting people back into network TV. So that's great. But like, yeah, I mean, I was someone who was like Wonder Years, Growing Pains. That was my stuff.
Yeah, but like Abbott Elementary and Goldbergs, like, they're still single cam shot on film. They have that more like cinematic style, where it's like, you know, they use cutaways, like they use like movie tricks for
single
jokes.
Cam, it still looks good. But you know, I think the current multicam world, what you got, I mean, I guess Fox and NBC are really trying to dominate that. They have like Call Me Cat, which I watched like one season, couldn't finish it. They tried to do that one song, Don't Call My Mother, or Call My Mother.
That's right. I think
it had like Kara Swisher in it.
Did CBS have that show with like United States of something? It was like a guy, like it was an Iraqi refugee show.
Oh yes, the United States of Al.
Yes, which I had never seen, but I saw promos for it. It looked really like, I'm like, oh, it's like Perfect Strangers. And then one night I'm watching it, and it was like around the Ukraine invasion, and the episode, like, I was just having to turn the TV on, and it was just about like war crimes.
Like, oh yeah, it's literally just like, it was just like about like a soldier and a translator coming back, and it was just a very weird like pro-America thing, and it got a lot of protests from like Middle Eastern organizations that were just like, this is not a good depiction of anything.
No.
And you know, CBS still owns that. Like, they have like Bob Loves Abishola.
Oh yeah, with the heavy guy and just
all these shows that are in like their 20th seasons, and it's just like, oh, they keep it on at a retirement home somewhere.
But that's the thing, like when I was growing up in like 1990, so like my sweet spot for TV is really like 88 to 92, which I think for most people it's like between ages 8 and 12. That's like the golden age for you, because you have your own taste, you don't leave the house, it's like perfect, right? So 1990 is like dead in that for me. It's perfect timing. And even though there were shows, I couldn't watch everything despite wanting to, I knew what was on. Like, if there was a show on for one season, I knew about it. There are shows that have been on CBS for like 35 years I've never heard of.
Oh, yeah. Where I'm just like, wait, what?
Yeah.
And like, there's some huge star usually, and you're just like, wait, that person's been doing that show there for decades. Yeah.
Duncan and Jack starring half the cast of Friends. What is this show? It's been out since 2003. You never saw? Yeah. So it's a very strange time. Also, side note, I kept a running list of non-human items and things that I had a connection to that got television credits before I did, which was a very long list. And one of them was some vintage Trapper Keepers I owned. I sold to the production manager of the Goldbergs, and they're in like three episodes.
There you go. Yeah. So, they're stars. Yep.
So yeah, that list also includes my DVD copy of Wonderfalls, which was on Last Comic Standing.
I loved Wonderfalls. I really loved that show. It was a great
show. Was it Brian Fuller? Yeah. I think it was, yeah. When before he got super horror focused. So always taken aback by the cigarette ads in the TV guide.
There were so many cigarette ads just like in the female focused ones, like I can smoke a cigarette right under my husband's nose with Virginia Slims.
Virginia Slims, and she's dressed like a Maybelline like bottle.
Yeah. I was just like, right, like back in the day they'd just be like, tear out this coupon and get 20 packs of cigarettes for a dollar. No wonder people were addicted. Yeah,
it's I always joke, but it's kind of half serious. In most issues of TV Guide, I never see the same cigarette brand twice. I'm like, there's 40 different cigarette brands in every issue. Like, how do we have this many cigarette brands? I've never heard of Malibu in my life. And then the Malibu one, it just says, move to Malibu.
Yeah, there was one that was like, it had like a deer on it or something. Yeah. And it was like, heard of this, but it was like H-E-R-D instead of H-E-R-D. I was just like, no, I haven't heard of this.
We did some market research and apparently puns get people to smoke, so we're gonna go full in here.
The smokers love puns. Yeah,
nothing says Malibu like cigarettes. You know, you picture all those surfers with a butt hanging out of their mouth while they're hanging 10. those people on the beach smoking.
Keeps the lungs healthy.
Certainly does. All that fresh air and sun is bad for you. You gotta balance it out. So Linda Evans is on the cover here because Dynasty is sort of the cover story. Now, I'll admit I've never seen Dynasty. Which is kind of a huge hole in my TV list of my TV experiences. Have you ever watched it?
I've watched some of it. My mom and grandma loved it. And when I would be stuck with my grandma, I would be like, okay. And I was more into Dallas, I think. And yeah, but I did like how this was just like, that's in the past. She's trying comedy now. She's getting lighthearted.
It didn't work.
Don't think it worked. Don't think that, that rebrand did not happen for her. But the like made for TV comedy movie did not, you know, do enough for her career.
There was a small blip in the late 80s, early 90s where, so the made for TV movies, and this for the listener, cause you know, this were mostly failed pilots, like 2-hour failed pilot movies. Yeah. And they went from, they did mostly horror and exploitation things, 70s and 80s. And then the 80s, they started getting into like ripped from the headlines, like horrible, you know, Farrah Fawcett gets abused movies. But then in the late 80s, early 90s, they're like, we're going to do all comedies for some reason. 2-hour comedies.
Yeah.
And then they were just like, oh no, we're back to the horrible things happening to people movies.
Yeah. Horrible things. Just like a lot of like this girl's a student and a hooker and murders people. Yeah. And it's just like, okay.
Her baby was stolen by her. Like, wait, how, what? I don't, cause
there was one that was like, is this her long lost son or a stranger who's going to murder her? And I'm just like, wow.
Maybe it's both.
What a question.
Cause we had a movie called Tricks of the Trade, which was Marky Post and, from Laverne and Shirley, the one who's not Laverne. I can't believe I forgot her name, but Marky Post was a sex worker, and the Laverne and Shirley lady was like a detective, and they like paired up. There was a series they tried to get going with Barbara Eden that was a ripoff of Private Benjamin, and it was called Your Mother Wears Army Boots. It's just like they were really trying, and it's pretty bad. It's pretty bad.
They tried.
There's one with, is it Tom Hanks? Where he's it's not Tom Hanks. I can't remember who it is now. But they're like a stand-up comic in LA trying to make it.
I've never heard of it. There were some made for TV movies in here that shocked me. There was like one with George Carlin and Ben Stiller, and I was like, I've never heard of this. Like,
it's,
I'd buy this on DVD.
Oh, I mean, that's always my complaint, is that with like short-lived series and TV movies are tailor-made for streaming services. Like, you own them, they're sitting in vaults, you probably have them all digitized, throw them on a server. Like, why wouldn't you do that?
I'll watch
it's like
a million people would start podcasts. Exactly. Like, oh, the TV movie of the week from, you know, 1993.
Yeah, I mean, come on. Then there's a big article in here with Marley Matlin, friend of the show, that was really fascinating because I forgot that she was a huge advocate for closed captioning.
Yeah, for closed captioning. And this is like when they were like, finally, closed captioning on every new TV. Yay.
Right. But then they were like, but even though only 25% of the shows are closed captioned.
Yeah.
It's like,
which is, yeah, I mean, and it's wild to think about it because now, like, I cannot watch a TV show without subtitles. Yeah. Like, I need to have them on.
With that age. That's the, What did you say? I couldn't read it.
Yeah, I'm just like, like, no, anytime, but I was back home with my family, they don't use captions. And I was just like, how can you guys understand any of these conversations? Right. I was like, I truly can't hear anything.
I always use it to know the characters' names and like who's talking. I'm like, who said that?
It's very good for that, too.
Plus the hidden world of the descriptors for sound effects is amazing.
I always love just like a, you know, paper moves crinklily or something. And it's like, okay, yeah.
The last season of Stranger Things used the phrase wet squelching in almost every episode. Which you don't hear enough of. But it's an interesting article here. And then there's, Heard of These Bucks Cigarettes is right next to a pretty interesting article about Malcolm Jamal Warner.
And what he learned growing up, Cosby.
Yeah. Not everything he learned. I feel so bad for him. Like, horrible.
Yeah, you know. And he's good. He's doing stuff now. I know he's, like, in some shows. And
he directs a lot.
Just like, dang, that's tough. Like, your biggest paycheck in terms of residuals is gone. Off the air.
Yeah, and it's hard enough being a former child actor from a hit series. Like, it's hard enough to transition. Like, this is a worst case scenario, really.
Yeah, and it's a, you know, but I guess he did learn some good things.
He did.
And I hope no bad
he
things.
He did. So. Yeah, because I've never heard anything bad about anyone else from The Cosby Show.
Yeah, nobody else, so.
Yeah. But then again, aside.
I'm hoping he never got an invite to the Playboy Mansion.
Oh, yeah, God. Aside from Keisha Knight Pullman, did anyone else really do anything?
Well, Felicia Rashad.
What was Felicia Rashad on after Cosby?
Oh, yeah, she's done like a ton of movies. Okay. And like, and now she's like the head of a school.
Oh, I love her.
Like a big college.
It's not Hellman. The weirdest thing is in the first season of Cosby, they made her Hispanic. I don't know if you remember this. And then they just completely, I think she was supposed to be like Dominican or something. So she would always speak like Spanish and it would kind of be like on the Addams Family when Morticia would speak French and Gomez would be like, oh, like it was kind of that thing with the two of them, which in hindsight is super creepy.
Oh my God. Yeah. I didn't know that.
And then they totally dropped it. It's really weird. If you rewatch, you're like, what's happening?
Yeah, I guess I didn't watch The Cosby Show live. And I feel like when I did, it was always just like reruns that were on like Nick at Night or something. Mm-hmm. Honestly, I wasn't a big Cosby person. It never really hit for me, you know? And I know for a lot of people, it's like that first big, you know, thing, but I preferred the Jeffersons and, you know, Good Times, honestly.
Well, they're more
Felicia, yes. Oh, right. She was just in Grey's Anatomy.
Okay.
I was literally like, she was in Grey's Anatomy.
That's good that she's a show I still watch because I've never seen it. That's been on for like 20 years, right? It's been some crazy.
Oh yeah. And I've watched it since day one. Ugh. Since day one, baby.
So her and Tisha Knight Pullman, I think are the only two,
Yeah. Oh, and I mean, I just consider Lisa Bonet famous.
Yeah. So. Although she's not in a lot. Like, she's in like four movies in 30 years, but is always just famous anyway. And Tempest.
Yeah. She doesn't need to be. Okay. She did her time and now she gets to be beautiful and we all love her.
Yeah. And she basically made a carbon copy of herself with her daughter who looks exactly like she did.
Exactly like her. And she was like, you go forth now.
Yeah. And we're like, oh, isn't that her? She's still in movies. Wasn't she in Batman?
She did give us a different world, and maybe she didn't stay on it, but I loved a different world.
I love a different world. It did get much sillier when she left. Like, I love Cree Summer, but like when she came in as like the way too dumb character, it got way more broad. And plus Whitley and Dwayne Wayne shouldn't have got to get, that was a mistake.
Absolutely disagree there, but okay.
Well,
we can agree to disagree.
I don't know. Like it ruined it. Like I'm a big proponent of the, when they do in a will they, won't they, it's always bad after.
I mean, most of the time I think so, but with them, I don't know. I just really love Whitley. I think she was always like the character that I was like, I love her.
She was great. Jasmine Guy is amazing. But it's, and then Tempest Blitzo had a talk show for a while. If you remember that.
Yeah.
When everyone had a talk show.
When they were just handing them out.
If they're giving Gordon Elliott a show, everyone else is getting a show. And then we have a really great two-page ad for Kindergarten Cop here.
I wrote that down in my notes. I went, amazing Kindergarten Cop double ad.
Yeah, this is fantastic. This would have been, like, this is the kind of thing where it's on two consecutive pages, but this would have been great as, like, a pop-up book kind of like double-sided thing.
The first one is like, you know, Schwarzenegger, classic, looks like a cop. You're like, oh my God, new Terminator, what's going on? And then you flip and he's with kids all over him. Yeah. He's Kindergarten Cop.
Yeah.
Tell him you don't have your homework.
I don't think a year has gone by since 1990 where somebody, I haven't heard somebody in person say, it's not a tumor.
I loved Kindergarten Cop growing up. I had no idea it came out so close to my birthday, but I just remember like I loved it. So the marketing worked. The marketing was good.
I mean, Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, I missed that. We don't get that in print today.
No, you don't. And Schwarzenegger pivoted to comedy well. He's in a few pretty great comedies.
Yeah,
which shouldn't make sense, but it did. And then we get Julio Iglesias Starry Night. Which I'm like, that doesn't look good at all.
Yeah, I think I just skipped right over that because I was so interested in the like 3-page K-Mart ad prices.
Oh God, yeah. And the Chic Jeans.
I was just like, oh my gosh, this TV's only $80.
But that's
all of it. I was like, that's surprisingly expensive. Like a TV stand for $284. I don't know. That's what I paid a day.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It's old TVs are shockingly expensive. Like the biggest screen you could get in a non-projection TV was 27 inches, right? Which is really small. And it was like a decent 27 inch TV was like $500.
Yeah, it's, but yeah, the prices on socks, those seem fair to me.
Those are pretty fair.
$2 pack.
Yeah. Sheer and Silky, pretty decent deal. And that sale on Chic Jeans, $16, like you can't go wrong with that.
Yeah. Too bad Kmart doesn't exist anymore.
No, I miss Kmart. Did you have a lot of Kmarts when you were growing up?
There were two big ones in Rockford, and one was like very close to my house. Like I have very vivid memories of like buying my first like day of school clothes at Kmart.
Yeah. And they always had a very specific, like a plasticky smell that I always kind of found comforting.
Yeah, I don't know. The vibe to me was, I always thought it was hip.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I was just like, I think they had a deal with like Joe Boxer.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if people remember that, like the smiley face brand. And I was just like, oh my gosh, they make Joe Boxer shirts and like underwear. It's so cool. So I always thought Kmart was so hip.
And they had a redesign in like 1987. So there was a lot of like neon. It looked like the set of the new Mickey Mouse Club.
Yeah.
So you were like, yeah, this is up to date, man. I always, and ours had a Little Caesars inside it.
Oh, nice. Ours, I know it had a restaurant inside. I don't think it was like a, it was just like they had Kmart hot dogs.
Yeah. Now you have to go to Costco for that sort of thing. And it's not the same.
This country's falling apart.
Not the same. Then there's a great article in here about the Motown 30th anniversary special, the What's Going On, which I remember watching and was, I loved this special. The 20th anniversary, I think it's the 20th one, is the one everyone talks about because it's when Michael Jackson made his like solo debut with the glove and everything.
Yeah.
But this one I think is a better special. Like it's
I mean, I when I saw it in here, I was like, I gotta check this out. Like you got Whoopi Goldberg in it. It looks so cool.
It was really cool. And the performances were great. They also like paid tribute to the sort of non-musical stuff Motown did, like the comedy record. Yeah. Like, so it's very good. I'd like to see it again. I haven't seen it probably since then, but very much.
I'm sure it's on YouTube.
Oh, I'm sure it is. And then, yeah. And I apologize for going through so much before we get to the listings, but this one is rich with stuff. It's the debut of Law and Order.
Law and Order.
And there's a review.
Yes, I wrote that in my notes too. I was like, the Law and Order reviewer, he's like, this new show. And I was just like, wow, the week of my birth, Law and Order, wow, yeah. That's iconic.
You and Law and Order, born at the same time, still going strong.
Yeah,
and
it got a great review. He's like, do I like it? Yes.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, Robert McKenzie loves Law and Order.
Loves Law and Order. Like, he is just like, it got, like, we're hoping it gets renewed. Like, oh my gosh, it's so great. And I mean, clearly, Dick Wolf had the magic.
He really did.
To this day, I'll sit down and watch Law and Order anywhere, anytime, any episode, any season, don't care.
Well, it's such a cliche now and such like a formulaic show now, but they kind of invented that formula. So there's a weird fly in the night room. They invented that formula and it was really new at this time. So it was like innovative and new, and it's weird to realize that.
Yeah, it's like at one point they're like, we didn't know if this, you know, this format that's so revolutionary would work. The cops find the criminal in the first half and the DA prosecutes in the second half. Yeah. But it works.
This is craziness.
Yeah, like, oh my goodness.
We can't do that. And then, of course, there's a holiday gift guide from a hardware store, which is one of the most boring gift guides I've ever seen. Like, no one's excited about any of these. No. A 5200 BTU thermostatic fan. Like, it's just not exciting. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, are these gifts for dad? What are we doing?
I think even a dad, like, that's like the dad equivalent of a vacuum cleaner. Link's like, oh, yeah. Thanks. You give me a heater because you want me to sit out in the garage and do things? Thanks. So let's dive in here. Saturday night. So you grew up in Central Time. So I will apologize in advance. You have to lower yourself to Eastern Time where you don't get the 10 o'clock shows.
I was a little like, you know, my prime time started earlier at my age, but, you know, I could adjust.
I was very envious of you people. You got extra hours of TV.
So when I was a kid, I didn't realize how time zones worked. So I was always like, well, maybe in the Midwest, we get TV shows an hour earlier, but they get out of school an hour earlier than us. And it's like, no, that's not how
there
that
works. There was no trade-off there. No, it was not like the Canadian
rule.
Yeah,
there was no trade-off, no. Actually.
It was just, you guys got to watch 10 o'clock things at 9. And,
at 9,
So not fair, but, you know, it is what it is. So what'd you do on Saturday?
Saturday, I picked Carol and Company with Bernadette Peters.
Yeah. Have you seen this show?
Oh, Carol and Company, yes. But when I saw like Bernadette Peters is joining, that's what put it on. At first I was like, I guess I just check into Golden Girls, you know, good TV. But when you throw in Bernadette Peters, I'm not saying no.
Yeah. I mean, from The Jerk alone, I will watch her and stuff.
Yeah.
I loved when she showed up on The Good Wife, which was fantastic. This show was strange. It's sort of the forgotten Carol Burnett show.
It is. It really is.
And each,
probably for good reason.
Yeah, there's some standouts. Like each episode is basically it's like a half hour sketch. Like each thing is like a standalone story and a half hour sketch. And there's one with Amy Sedaris in it. It's actually her first on screen credit because she used a lot of Second City people in 1990. And there's one where like her and Carol Burnett play like mother and daughter who are like being held hostage in an apartment. It's just really weird. It's not super funny, but it's just strange.
I mean, I'm going to find this on YouTube like as soon as we're done.
Oh, it's worth watching, but it was people hated this show because it was Carol Burnett's return to sketch comedy. So people were like, awesome. But she was way more hip than people gave her credit for.
Yeah.
And was like, I'm not just going to do like the new Carol Burnett show. Like, let's do something different. And, you know, to this day,
yeah, weird. You know, it's a different time in sketch comedy. You got In Living Color, all this stuff now. Let's change it up.
Yeah. How do you stand out? Let's do basically an anthology show. And to this day, no one's done an anthology comedy show because it doesn't really work. But
it does not really work.
Because sketches, I mean, we all know the SNL sketches where you're like, oh, you didn't have an ending? This went on too long?
Yeah. Is this going to end? I would say, yeah, the only thing that maybe comes close is Kroll Show, but they had enough sense to like break it up, you know?
So yeah, they took like a next step from the Mr. Show Monty Python thing where they had like a through line, but it's still basically a sketch, which I think's kind of the only way to do it. This was just like half hour sketch. You passed up super bloopers and new practical jokes.
I saw that one, and I think the older brother from the Wonder Years was one of the guys,
Jason Hervey.
Sinbad, and I was like, that would get me. I would watch that.
Yeah, I would love. It's Sinbad. Sinbad is led on a wild goose chase through the streets of Las Vegas.
I would watch that. Yeah, I would.
I'm kind of interested in that now. Hervey, I could take or leave. He seems like a real dickhead.
I love the Wonder Years, but
same. Yeah. Oh yeah. He plays his character is him. and I'm saying that I haven't heard that, but, yeah, I've had Olivia Dabo on the show. She was great. Oh. I love the Wonder Years. Have you been to the Wonder Years neighborhood in Burbank?
No.
Oh, the Arnold's.
I didn't even know that was like a thing.
Oh yeah. Their street is just this street in Burbank and it looks exactly the same. I'll send you the address for when you go back.
Please. I'm going to have to go there with like a crush and recreate some memories where I'm Winnie and it all works.
Winnie's
out.
House is there, the Pfeiffer house. And it's the same. It's pretty strange, but then there's palm trees that you realize were always just out of frame.
Yeah. Just right there.
Very, very strange. So you're watching Carol and Company. Then what else?
For Saturday?
Yeah. Anything else?
Then Golden Girls. Truly, those were the only two that I was like,
yeah, fair enough.
I guess Saturday Night Live was on there. I watch Saturday Night Live to this day, so I guess I'd probably put that on too.
Who was on Saturday? Oh, this is from 1988, and it's Rick Moranis hosting. I love Rick Moranis. And I don't remember this episode.
Love Rick Moranis.
He's so good.
But I feel like 88, that's a rough year for SNL, I feel like.
Yeah, it was pretty transitional. Yeah. But you were started. It was before the like Bad Boys, but you
before the SNL Bad Boys.
Yeah, but you still had like you still had Hartman and Lovitz, and I like Nora Dunn a lot. I thought she was totally underrated.
I love Nora Dunn. Yeah, activist, fighter, history is on her
so
side.
So good. Yeah, I need to revisit this one because I'm a huge SCTV fan, and this is probably the only other sketch show Rick Moranis ever did, and I'm curious to see how he. Because he did some great, just bizarre stuff on SCTV. So good. What a weird dude. So that's Saturday. How about on Sunday?
Sunday, I picked the Motown 30 What's Going On. I mean, come on. After that read-up, how could I say no to that?
Yeah.
And it sounds like that would have been worth my time. And then I went with In Living Color.
Yeah, that... I have mixed feelings about Living Color. I don't know how you feel about it. Well, it'd be different for you because it was always revisiting it, right?
Yeah, for me, it was always revisiting. I mean, I would guess I saw the highs more than the lows because I feel like I've mostly seen like best ofs and just like the big sketches. So I'm sure there are lows in those episodes that I would be like, oh, this is what it was like to sit through this.
Yeah, it was because I loved I'm Gonna Get You Sucker. And I love Robert Townsend. I love Hollywood Shuffle. And I was like, oh, it's people from both those things. And like, this is like Hollywood Shuffle, the TV series. And so I was very excited for it. It was definitely, there was nothing like it on television when it started in 1990. So we're in the first year here.
Yeah. But it's still fresh and it's changing things.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, it was, it got a lot of credit because they brought on a lot of hip hop acts that like couldn't get attention on modern, on like, you know, more mainstream stages. Yeah. So from that, I've always just been like, I'd like to experience it in real time, maybe.
And I still call Sean Wayans SW1. I refuse to call him Sean Wayans. But then there were sketches that were like, even at the time, I was like, come on, guys. You can do better than this. Like, Handyman is the one I always bring up where I'm like, come on, Damon Wayans. You're smarter than this. Like, the joke is not how people react to him. You're just laughing at a handicapped person every week. Like, this is...
Every week, yeah. You know, it's tough time for comedy.
Yeah, it is bad when you like the people and you know they're really good and they're doing stuff that you're like, because you're like, you can do better than this. Come on.
Yeah, come on. You can do
but
better.
But there were some hilarious things on that. Have you ever heard the story about when Damon Wayans got himself fired from SNL?
I don't think so.
He was on the first year Lorne Michaels came back as a featured player. And no one wrote for him, because at SNL you have to basically like sell yourself to the writers who write for you.
And if you're a black or a woman, best of
they're like, I don't know how to write for you. I wrote to Harper. I don't understand you. And so the only character he did, he ended up doing again on In Living Color. It was like the like those kind of hustler guys who would sell like stolen goods out of the back of the car. I think him and David Alan Grier did it on but it was him, and the other one was played by Anthony Michael Hall. So they did it like twice on the show, but that was really the only character he had. So he was doing a sketch where he was just like a cop who had like one line in a sketch, and he decided he was going to play it flamboyantly gay. Like, I mean, huge. And the quote is, Lorne Michaels watched it and went, oh, he just quit. We got fired immediately.
God, Lorne Michaels.
What a weird creep.
What a person who, you shouldn't speak ill of people who probably aren't going to be with us for long.
No, that's so true. That's true. And I've already had so many people have spoken ill on the show with SNL people have been on, but what a strange guy. There's also, one of my favorite ever SNL sketches is Damon Wayans is in it, and it's when Tom Hanks hosted in 85, and they're all stand-up comedians. Have you ever seen this one?
I feel like I have, because I used to watch all the SNL reruns on Comedy Central.
They're all backstage, and they all talk like this, because it's 80s stand-up. And he goes, why do they call it French toast? I'll make it in my kitchen. Should be called kitchen toast. And it's Damon Wayans is so funny, because there's like a thing where they're like, hey, you ever see this guy anymore? He goes, he died. He had cancer. It was real bad. It's the same cadence. Love it. Again, good choice. Sorry, I went on a huge tangent there. I got too excited.
I love sketch comedy.
What's your favorite sketch show of all time?
That's a tough question. That's hard. I'm just gonna say Tracy Ullman. I'm not gonna pick a series, or I'm just Tracy
it's
Ullman.
It's a good call. She and very underrated.
Yes, very underrated, but that was some of the like early like HBO female comedy I remember watching and being like, you can be weird? Oh my gosh.
Yeah, she always just gets mentioned as like, you know, The Simpsons started, but like...
Yeah, that's how The Simpsons started, and it's like, that there was so much more.
She would completely disappear in character, she would get grotesque, her stuff's very SCTV-ish, good call.
Yeah.
There's also a really weird two-page spread for the Family Channel that night. And this is all their original series, and they had some weird ass shows.
I think there was one like The Black Stallion or something.
There was the new Adventures of the Black Stallion, which was like a remake of an old show, as was Zorro. Border Town, which was a Western, which was weird because people weren't doing Westerns on TV. A remake of Rin Tin Tin Canine Cop. Then the Canadian show Maniac Mansion, which actually was pretty good and had Joe Flaherty, but was based on a video game. And then the show Big Brother Jake, which was based around Jake Steinfeld, who was a personal trainer to celebrities, and then got a sitcom where he has a house full of foster children.
That was just that period of time when they were like, just put a bunch of kids with him and that's a TV show.
Yeah, it was like, hey, my personal trainer's pretty cool. Maybe we could do a show with him.
Yeah, I think there's a show about that.
Perfect. Anything else on Sunday?
That was it. That's all I had.
Let's do Monday. Oh, first of all, I do want to mention there's a Christmas ad for phones.
Yeah.
This is pretty great. A 200.
It's one of the best things you can get for Christmas, a phone.
A Mickey Mouse phone at that. A $250 phone. Not a cell phone.
That's still too expensive.
It has up to 10 numbers you can program into it. I mean, we're in the future.
That's high tech.
We're in the future. Yep. So there's the Motown. Where are we? Monday. Oh, the Linda Evans movie was on Sunday night as well.
It was.
I'll take romance. To find romance, she took out the largest personal ad in the world, the 6 o'clock news. And it's just like all these dudes in tuxes. Oh, it looks so bad.
You've got my attention. Like, let's go. I'm in.
I kind of want to see this now because it really does look terrible.
Yeah.
And then an HBO original movie that looks really intense because it stars George C. Scott, Diane Lane, and Eric Roberts, and it's called Descending Angel. And it says, a loving father or a mass murderer? Uncovering the truth could be deadly.
But those are the only two options. Uh-oh.
It's one or the other. Yeah, you can't. It's a
only one or the other.
It's a very binary choice. I mean, maybe that's true with George C. Scott. Monday, what'd you do?
Monday, I picked Designing Women, Fresh Prince, and the Ben Stiller, George Carlin movie, Working Trash.
So I was a diehard CBS Monday night person. This was the tail end of it, but Designing Women was still on. Newhart, it was like Designing Women, Newhart, Kate and Allie, and then later Murphy Brown, Major Dad. Oh, yeah. But the other three, big fan. And God, I love Designing Women.
I love Designing Women. Not as much as Golden Girls, but I loved it. Yeah.
See, I feel like I rewatch Designing Women much more often than Golden Girls.
Oh, absolutely not. I rewatch Golden Girls probably like every week. If Golden Girls is on, it's on my TV.
Like, oh yeah. If it's on and I see it, I will stop and watch it. But like, I feel like I go out of my way to watch Designing Women.
Yeah, when Betty White died, I did a like pretty full rewatch. I just kind of like started from the beginning, and I was just like, it's still so good. It's so well written. I still loved it.
It feels very timeless because of the setting and the age of the leads. It kind of doesn't have an 80s vibe in a good way. Designing Women is the opposite.
Oh, yeah. Designing Women feels very of its period. Yeah.
But like Meshach Taylor was so good. And Delta Burke is just
an amazing cast. Oh. Yeah.
And it's funny that out of all those people, Jean Smart is like the person who everybody's like, oh, yeah, Jean Smart can do anything. She's amazing. She's in everything now. I would not have. Look, she's great. Yeah. But I would not have guessed that from that cast.
No. I would not have thought from Designing Women. Yeah.
And this is right before Delta Burke quit. So this is like the last season with kind of the original cast.
Yeah. So this is, you know, original flavor Designing Women right here.
Before they got Jan Hooks in there and friend of the show, Julia Duffy, who's great and everything. The world premiere movie tonight, two working stiffs are going to do to Wall Street what it's done to us.
And then
it's
a giant screw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This, again, was a Fox attempt at a series. Fox was, there was a bunch of attempts to get George Carlin on a TV show. None of them worked. There was a Showtime sitcom pilot that is god awful. There's a Disney show where he played a dead detective called Just in Case. And then the George Carlin show in the 90s, which was like they crossed Taxi with Cheers and somehow made that not good.
Some comics can be so funny, they don't work on TV.
It just doesn't. And it had an amazing cast. Like, they stacked the cast. Like, Alex Rocco's in it. And so I've never seen this, but I'm assuming, because this would be concurrent with the Ben Stiller show, also on Fox.
I think so.
I'm assuming this is awful, but I feel like I want to see it.
I want to see it. I'm going to look it up, and I bet it's amazing.
Yeah, because I don't even
remember. I bet it's just a lost, beautiful hit that people are like, oh, I wish I could own it.
We got to reboot this movie. And then there's a Rue McClanahan star.
It has a 4.9 on IMDb.
Oh, 4.9 out of 10.
Out of 10.
Okay.
Out of 10.
Yeah. Okay. Then there's a Rue McClanahan starring made for TV movie also on at the same time, though, which yes. is inspired by a true story. Nothing can break the special bond between a mother and her child.
Mother and a daughter.
Not misunderstandings, yeah. not distance, not tragedy. To my daughter. Starring Emmy winner Rue McClanahan as you've never seen her. I don't get what that.
Yeah.
I don't know if I.
You never, you haven't seen her do this on Golden Girls.
No. Be in a broken locket and sad.
Yeah. Sad.
Yeah. I don't think I would. I'd have to go with the George Carlin Ben Stiller show as
yeah.
well. Ben Stiller, also a short-lived SNL cast member.
Yeah.
I don't think he got fired, though. Tuesday? Where are we?
Yeah, Tuesday. Tuesday, I chose 30-something, a show that I actually had to watch in college, Growing Pains. And then I went with The Days and Nights of Princess Di because, hey, the new season of The Crown is out, so...
See, there you go. See how they did it when it was contemporary.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a weird night. So like 30 something is a show I watched at this time, even though I was 10 years old. It doesn't make any sense why a 10-year-old would watch this. And when I've tried to go back and watch it, I'm like, these people are assholes.
Oh yeah, it's horrible. I was taking a class in college that was literally just like the history of the 1980s. And they made us watch this entire show. We would literally, like, they'd assign it as homework. And I was just like, this is horrible. What are we supposed to take from this? That yuppies were terrible people? Yeah. Okay, I get it.
Oh, our lives are terrible. We're well off and live outside Pittsburgh.
Yeah. Like,
I will say, like, the cast is good. And it did give us My So-Called Life. Like, the creators is My So-Called true, Life, true. which I'm cool with. But... I remembered loving it and then rewatching it as an adult. I'm like, I'm mad at me as a child. That's yeah. where we're at now. Rescue 911 I always watched because I still think it's hilarious. The Days and Nights of Princess Di. This is part of Evening Magazine, which was our local sort of news magazine show. I don't know why a local Boston news show has an episode about Princess Di. Does she really lead a fairy tale
life?
Straight
to the source. Straight to the source.
From morning to midnight, see how Princess Di spends her royal days.
I want to know.
We were obsessed with it. Obsessed. I mean, I guess because we don't have princesses, but like...
Yeah, you know, and she was like, she was exciting, and everyone's like, oh, she's like living this dream, but is she?
No, she was sad inside. She was the clown that cried.
She was sad.
They're also showing the movie 52 Pickup, which is fucking great. I don't know if you've ever seen that movie.
No idea.
Oh, it's Elmore Leonard, and it's a crime movie. Vanity is in it and is really good. John Glover is the villain, and he is terrifying. And Margaret is in it. It's like a really good crime movie if you like crime movies, which I do. I'm trying to see what Growing Pains is that night. So this would have been by the time I had checked out on Growing Pains, because we're in full like Jesus Kurt Cameron, because we're in season 4.
Yeah
Where are we here?
And yeah, for me, I just watched Growing Pains, I guess, mostly in syndication. Like it used to come on when I was home from school, I think on like ABC Family or something.
Yeah, that would make sense. It was one of those shows that was on for like 2 hours a day. Like TBS would air it for an hour.
Yeah, and it was then just like always on. Yeah. And I would just be like, okay.
I loved that show for like 2 seasons. Then I was like, ugh.
Alan Thicke felt like my own dad. So
was your dad a stay-at-home psychiatrist?
No, not at all. But Alan Thicke probably provided more advice to me than my dad.
Yeah,
did,
no, so. Same. Yeah, he had like a nice quality about him that wasn't TV dad cheesy. It was yeah. like you felt
he
like
wasn't. Yeah, there was something realistic, and he would get upset, but you know, not like the Seventh Heaven dad over dumb stuff. It was always like, yeah, this is reasonable. He's just like asking his kids to be good people.
Yeah, and if like you were in trouble, he could like get shit done. He could help you out, yeah. You know. I was talking about the other day. Have you ever seen the suicide episode of that show?
I don't remember.
I've rewatched it. It is insane. It is it's very well done, and they're clearly going for an Emmy, but it's because In My Name is Alex, the Family Ties episode, had won an Emmy. So I think they were like, we can do this. So basically one of Mike's friends is troubled and kind of ends up being the whole episode is this conversation between her and Dr. Seaver in the driveway of the house about how she's going to kill herself. And it's just a half hour, you know, 22 minutes of them talking about it. Super weird like for a family sitcom. But again, I mean, getting stuff that like kids didn't, you know, you didn't hear about that or talk about that with your family. So, also, did you see the world premiere movie on CBS that night?
Was it the Angel one?
Oh, no. This one stars Kate Jackson and Rick Schroeder in the world premiere movie, The Stranger Within. And this is exactly the one you mentioned, referenced earlier. It's, is he her son who was kidnapped 16 years ago, or a dangerous stranger, or both?
Oh, no, that's don't give me that option.
Yeah. It was one or the other. I can't pick between both. I am curious to see how terrible that is.
Yeah.
Chris Sarandon. This is when Rick Schroeder was trying to rebrand himself after Silver Spoons and before bailing out Kyle Rittenhouse. Piece of shit, Rick Schroeder. Fuck yourself. Oh, that's me saying it. What a garbage person. That's just a guy who was called Ricky to his face longer in life than he should have. And we all have to pay the price for it.
Yeah. And that messes with you.
Yeah. But still, you know, Alfonso Ribeiro came out fine and he was on the same show.
True. Yeah.
He's not bailing out murderers.
No.
And in truck convoys, but you know, I'm on my high horse now. Wednesday. What are we doing?
Wednesday, I went with Six Ladies Laughing. It was like some comedy special, I guess, with like a bunch of funny people that I love. It had Kim Fields. That's the only name I'm remembering right now. But I was like, man, they don't even let six women be funny on TV today on network TV. Yeah. So this must have been special.
I love Kim Fields. I did a show with her in LA years ago, and she was just like the coolest and had just awesome stories.
Yeah, she's very nice. So cool.
She was great. I'm trying to see who else. Where is this? Six Ladies. This is on Wednesday. Oh, yeah. It's on Lifetime.
That one lady from SNL was on
it. Victoria Jackson.
Yeah, Victoria Kim Jackson. Kim Coles.
Henriette Mantel. Andrea Martin's hosting it. Sue Kalinske, who I don't know. And Stephanie Hodge, who I don't know. I have this special. I have a tape of this special.
Oh, wow.
Because I remember Andrea Martin hosting it. If you want to see it, I can get you a copy.
Absolutely.
80s stand-up on TV, I would watch all day, every day, and I still will.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of it. Just any old stand-up stuff, like, give it to me, please.
Do you have any that, like, is a like your go-to? Like, there are some specials, like, that I'll watch over and over again, specifically 80s ones.
Yeah, I mean, actually, the 80s ones, I really like Def Comedy Jam. I'll go back and revisit. I think there was, like, a HBO On Location special that they used to run. That's from the 80s, but for my age group, I feel like I really returned to like Premium Blend specials, the Comedy Central, like Premium Blend. Mm-hmm. That was like, I would stay home from school so I could watch those.
Do you remember Pulp Comics?
Yeah, Pulp Comics.
That was so good. I don't know why. I think it was the best format for stand-up specials ever. It was like, if you remember the format, it was like comics doing a long set in kind of a nightclub, like a jazzy kind of cool nightclub. And then they'd intercut like sketches based on their stand-up. So it was kind of like a, you know, and Bobcat Goldthwait did an amazing one. Laura Keitlinger did one that was really great.
I love Laura Keitlinger, yeah.
But then Comedy Central was like, nah, this was too much work.
Yeah. Too much. We don't like to do things that people like.
No. We just throw whatever shit on there. We don't need to do this, put this much thought into a stand-up special. Forget it. So this is Lifetime TV. This is when Lifetime TV was still being billed as television for women.
Yes.
It was literally their tagline.
Yeah, television for women. I was that when I was growing up. Yeah.
Which, I mean, I get, it sounds horrible now, but it was kind
of
nice.
Yeah, that's how people used to do TV, that like all of these ad execs were like, HBO is for men, Lifetime is for women. That's how we do it.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, they showed some good stuff on Lifetime. They were like, they did the Days and Nights of Molly Dodd. They picked up after that got canceled and they did new episodes of that. Yeah, I watched a lot of Lifetime as a 10-year-old boy.
So did I. My mom always had it on. I was mostly just watching Golden Girls and The Nanny. And then it would be like whatever made for Lifetime movie. So.
And Lifetime also used to show Shop Till You Drop. Do you remember that game show?
I kind of remember that, yeah.
The announcer was Mark L. Wahlberg. Not Mark Wahlberg, the Antiques Roadshow.
Not yet, different one.
But it was, yeah, it was sort of like Supermarket Sweep, but you were in like a fake mall. I loved it.
Yeah.
Anything else on Wednesday?
That was it. The six ladies laughing. I was like, this would be my night.
And it's Christmas themed in the ad because they're all on like balls.
Yeah, they're like on Christmas balls and stuff.
Because I guess it's like six ladies laughing. But.
Oh, yeah. That okay. There it is. Yeah.
The special is not Christmas themed in any way. So I don't know what that. And Lifetime also did like. Four Elaine Boozler specials.
Wow.
Which were all pretty good. And a Rita Rudna special, actually, that was really good as well. So they were really pumping out the lady stand-up specials. There's a lot of made-for-TV movies on this week.
Yeah.
There's one on USA.
This was like around the holidays, I think. I think like Thanksgiving had just happened probably the week before.
Oh, yeah. But is that like people are like, well, I ate a lot of turkey, so tonight I want to see Faye Dunaway.
Yeah, you get days off. It's like, stay home, watch a movie.
This sounds like a complete joke. Like based on the thing we saw in the Rick Schroeder where it was like, is he this or both? This seems like a parody of that. It's a USA world premiere movie, Silhouette, starring Faye Dunaway. And it says, she's the sole witness, the prime suspect, and maybe the next victim. What? How
you got to solve that one?
Oh, I don't know how that works. And then there's a thing on. Speaking of Alan Thicke, did you see the tube test?
I did the tube test, which I don't know if that ran for a while, but I do kind of remember Alan Thicke hosting like a game show, being like, "I know so much about TV, I would love to do this."
He did a show called Animal Crackups. If you remember, that was a
yes,
game show.
I remember that one.
But I don't know if this was a reoccurring show. It might have been. Yeah, but this would have been right up our alley. Like this is,
yeah, would have been great.
TV trivia hosted by Alan Thicke. Sign me up. Have you ever gone back and watched Thick of the Night episodes?
No, I've never done that.
I kind of recommend it, but also don't.
I have never watched it in the first place. So
I watch them every so often first run, but not really. But as an adult, I've gone back just out of curiosity and, wow, that it's shocking because it's super sleazy. Like they love mud wrestling on Thick of the Night. Like it'll just be for no reason. They'll get mud wrestling on there. And
I would not have put that with Alan Thicke, but
nope.
Wow.
And he's making a lot of sexual jokes. And then because the show was, they spent a ton of money on it. And the ads were literally like, look out, Johnny Carson. Someone's coming to murder you. Like they were like, he's the cool. So they were really trying to make this show work. So then like halfway through, this only lasted one season. They started getting other comics to co-host with him. And Arsenio Hall ended up being like the regular co-host. And then at some point it basically becomes Arsenio Hall's show. Like Alan Thicke, like isn't really there that much anymore.
I mean, Arsenio, he's a powerhouse.
It's true, but it's a weird like evolution to watch in real time. Cause you know, it's not often that Arsenio Hall replaces mud wrestling.
Yeah. Yeah.
But maybe it should happen more often. Then there was a horrible ad for the Defenders of Animal Rights that made me really sad. And I'm sorry I saw again. And then we're on Thursday.
Yeah. Thursday I went with The Simpsons.
It's still on Thursdays at this point. This is when they took on The Cosby Show head on, which was a big deal. A big deal.
And what show is still on the air? Homer Simpson's not canceled.
That's true. That's true. He hasn't aged a day either. The funny thing is they didn't do well being against Cosby, but it was like they only did it for one season.
I wouldn't think that would really be a split audience right there, but yeah. It's not like there was a lot of TV back
no,
then.
No, so. It's narrow casting. There wasn't a lot for families to watch at 8 o'clock. Yeah, I feel like if you're a Simpsons fan, you probably weren't a Cosby Show fan, although I guess I was both. So, but it was like America's favorite family. We're taking you down, Cosby. Which, you know, I think today the Simpsons should get credit for.
Yeah, yeah. They were kind of the first wave, I think.
But yeah, they didn't do well on Thursdays, but it got so much press. It was more of a stunt, really.
Yeah.
And then they moved to Sundays and, you know, obviously did very well because nothing was on Sundays.
They're still on Sundays.
Do you still watch it?
Not really. If a friend has written an episode, then I'll watch, but I'm more of a Bob's Burgers girl. That's all I really do on my Sunday. They still get animation domination. Yeah.
Because you also know a bunch of people that do voices and write shows.
Yeah.
Does it? Yeah. Do you have difficulty getting into the shows? Sometimes I do.
Sometimes I do. There was like one. Duncanville. I had a hard time getting into that one because so many of my friends were in it and like wrote it, and I was just too like, that's not that character. That's this person I know.
Right, right. Or if it's people you know really well, you like want to text them and be like, come on, dude, this joke, you should have punched that up.
Yeah, like, okay, I'm not, you know, and then they just like see the silence. I'm not saying anything. And they're like, okay, I guess that's how you felt about it.
Yeah. It is crazy to me how huge Bob's Burgers is because it's like 80% Boston comics that I started with.
Yeah, it's so good. It just keeps getting better every season.
But I had
it's crazy.
A friend I hadn't seen in years was visiting from Florida, and his kids were with him, and they were like 9 years old. And his kid couldn't believe that I knew Eugene Merman. it was like I knew Superman. And intellectually, I get that's a popular show, especially among kids, but it was such a weird thing. I was like, really?
Yeah, like, yeah, oh, that's exciting to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah, look, here's a poster. He's on it. And Thursday night, one of Fox's more troubling shows is on. I don't know if you saw it. Babes.
Oh, yeah, I didn't see that.
Are you familiar with Babes?
Not at all.
So Babes was a sitcom, which actually had a really good cast. Like Wendy Jo Sperber was in it. Rick Overton was in it. But the premise is they're all overweight sisters. So we're calling it Babes because they're not. They're actually not.
Oh, that's horrible.
Horrible. And literally the whole premise of the show was just they were like three overweight women.
You could get away with so much in the 90s.
Yeah. It's funny that they have a show where the title of the show is an ironic dig at the people on the show.
Yeah. I'm guessing the movie Babe wasn't out at this point.
No. The Babe had come out.
I feel like they're probably, I would have assumed they were making some reference, horrible reference to that too.
To pigs. Yeah. I don't know what would be worse there. I'm like, although Babe Pig in the City, one of my favorite movies.
Very good. Very good. Yeah.
How it's set when Fleelig gets hit by the car and his little wheel.
Ah.
I saw that in the theater alone.
Classic.
A children's movie where the message is the world doesn't care about you. Which is great. The Flash is on, which I totally would have watched as well. Loved Amanda Pays. Alex Desert is in this, who was the singer for the band Hepcat in the late 90s, is the ska band Hepcat. The Flash I was all in on, and in hindsight is not a great show because the Flash is not Batman and they tried to make him Batman. Is there a show that you went back and watched like from this era that was a huge surprise, like you couldn't believe how well it held up?
I couldn't. I mean, The Simpsons, obviously. I was like, oh, of course this still holds up. It's The Simpsons. It's hard because I'm like, I watched these when they were in syndication, so I'm like, they did hold up.
Right.
Because I was watching after they aired. But I think I was shocked by how much I still hated 30-something, I guess.
Yeah. No, I feel like that's a good litmus test for like if you're a good person or not.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you watch that and you're like, I love these people.
Yeah, like, oh my god, they're so good. I want to be like them. You're a horrible person. Yeah,
nope, you failed. Is there a show that was like a classic television show that you rewatched and you're like, oh no, I don't like this?
I didn't look at any of the ones I kind of hated
already.
I guess there was one with like Quantum Leap with someone playing Jack Kerouac, and I was like, well, that sounds horrible.
Yeah, that does sound pretty bad. Quantum Leap could be pretty hit or miss at times. Not Babe's Miss.
Like a Jack Kerouac Quantum Leap, like who cares?
Not a Babe's Miss, but still a miss. Anything else on Thursday, or is that your whole night?
That was it. I just had The Simpsons.
That's a good night. Friday, the final night of the week. What are you doing?
Yeah, I did pick the Quantum Leap with Jack Kerouac. I was like, I mean,
after just saying you
hit it, sounds awful. I was like, I need to see how this goes. Like, what even is the story?
It is always weird when shows do like a historical fiction for like real people.
Yeah.
Did you see Legends of Tomorrow? Did you watch that at all?
I don't think so. No.
It was a DC show. It took place in the Flash universe, but they did one a few years ago.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I had a friend who wrote on that show, actually.
It's kind of a fun show, but they did one where they travel back in time and Barack Obama in college helps them, like, in that episode, like, solve the case that week. And it was kind of a fun idea, but it really weirded me out.
Yeah, I'm just like, I don't, like, okay, I know that person exists. I don't care.
Right, I'm like, you have a real person, like, you have an actor playing this real person who's still alive doing this thing that never happened. Like, I was trying to think of if there were, I guess we had shows when I was a kid where, like, people would play Nixon or something. I was going to say, like, Lincoln, but, like, that's totally different. But I'm like, it's weird that that's, like, a historical figure in a television show. not quite Jack Kerouac.
Yeah, not quite.
Growing up here, he is like a god because he's from Lowell, Mass, and his grave there. And I think we've moved past generations of people here who like just totally worship him. But
yeah, based their whole personalities on the road.
Yeah, I'm like, dude. I always like to point out to him, like, you know, it's just hippies. It's just hippies before hippies. And like, no, I'm like, no, it's hippies.
Yeah, that's all it is.
No. Anything else on Friday night?
That was all I had. I did see there was Family Matters, but I was never a Family Matters fan.
Nah, it got really silly. To wrap up, was there anything that you, like a comfort show or anything that you rewatched during the pandemic?
Oh, I mean, there were a few. I watched all of Sex and the City for the first time during the pandemic, which was interesting. Like, I'd never seen it before.
Did you like it?
I did. It like grew on me. I really was like, when I was growing up, I was very anti that show. I was like, that's what preppy girls watch. Me I don't too. Care. And then rewatching, I was like, I mean, a lot of them still annoy me and I do feel cooler than all of them, but I like knowing these cultural references.
Maybe that's why you liked it.
And it did make me laugh. And I love Samantha. Well, what other comfort shows did I do a lot of like reality TV as comfort shows. Like I would binge Hoarders, Evil Lives Here.
Oh, heavy reality TV shows. You're not watching Chopped. Yeah,
I don't do the light reality TV. Like I don't really do the Bravo universe. Like the Real Housewives, all that stuff. I'm just kind of like, okay, but I want the reality shows where it's like actual people ruining their lives.
You're watching Locked Up Abroad and Scared Straight.
Yeah. Stuff. Intervention. Ooh. That's the good stuff.
Fair enough. You know, I can respect that. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I'm so glad we got to chat. And like I said, if people like your show, if people like this show, they'll love your show.
Yeah, you come TV I Say. We talk about all the new shows that are out every week. I talk to the people behind the shows, why they love TV. And I mean, just reading through this, it's just, as a TV person, I was like, I need to just look at old TV guides more. This is so fun.
Well, if you ever need some, you know where to get them.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, I have I have 7 made for TV movies I need to find and watch now.
Yeah, that's why you have to go. That's what you're doing tonight.
Yeah, bring back the made for TV movie. I think now they try to get away with these like limited series sitcoms. No,
not the same.
Just give me all Wednesday night. Boom.
Yep. Yep. I want to see Linda Evans in a comedy where she is a murderer and the victim. Thank you so much. I appreciate you doing this.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. Oh, baby, I see you.
There you go. That's Ashley. As I mentioned, super cool. Listen to her show. I'll put links in the show description and in all the social media so you can find her, or you can just Google her as well. If you want to get in touch with me, I am at Kenneth W. Reed on most of the things, or at TV Guidance on most of the things. You can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. There's a mailing list on tvguidancecounselor.com, or even better for me, you can become a patron for as little as $1 a month. You can contact me whenever you want on there and see exclusive content. I'm making more videos. Let me know what you'd want to see on there to sign up, because every dollar is a huge help to doing this show. I am a one-man production, research, hosting, booking crew here. But, you know, I chose this life for myself. And I'll choose this life again next week when I have a brand new episode. So I hope you be here for that brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.